Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Tonight, it's actor, activist, and icon, George Takei.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
He came to fame as Sulu on the original Star Trek TV series, and he was fond of all of his castmates, except one.
There was one name that you didn't mention. William Shatner.
Uh-huh.
George Takei on Star Trek, on Coming Out, and on his musical Allegiance, inspired by his own life story. Our conversation when we come back.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
George, welcome.
Good to be here.
Let's talk about Star Trek. That's where I think so many people really got to know you. Obviously, you'd been working as an actor or learning as an actor up until that moment. How did you get to be on Star Trek?
Well, I was a working actor by that time. I studied acting at UCLA. I had a track record by 1965 when my agent called and said he had an interview for me with a man named Gene Roddenberry, who that name didn't mean anything to me at all.
Right.
He said it's a pilot for a series, a sci-fi thing, and the sci-fi thing meant nothing to me. It was a pilot for what could be steady employment if it sold.
it didn't matter that it was called Star Trek or Gene Roddenberry. It wasn't the thing that it is now, this
yes.
massive franchise.
Went to the interview, went to the receptionist. I mispronounced Gene's surname. I said, I'm here to see Mr. Rosenberry. And she corrected me.
Yeah.
So when I walked into his office, I said his name properly. But then he mispronounced my surname. The E-I in my surname, Takei.
Yeah.
People want to give the Germanic pronunciation, like Einstein.
Right.
He called me George Takei.
Right.
And so I said, well, it's pronounced Takei. But I told him, I don't object to the mispronunciation because there is a Japanese word that is pronounced Takei.
Right.
And it means expensive.
That's right.
He says, oh my goodness, I don't like to call actors expensive. You're definitely Takei. And he quickly memorized the proper pronunciation. So that's how my relationship with Gene Roddenberry began,
that's
with
funny.
Mispronunciations.
That's hilarious.
Mutual.
And as you get cast and you start shooting this series, when you're shooting it, do you realize it's special?
Yes, I realized that the scripts were very well written, and they were imaginatively written, and that they were metaphors for issues of the time.
Mm.
That made it exciting. Mm. But our ratings were very low. So we were special in many ways.
Including low
we
ratings.
Couldn't find our audience.
Huh.
Season after season. As a matter of fact, NBC wanted to cancel us after the second season.
Mm.
But the fans mounted a huge letter-writing campaign. And they gave us a third season, but the ratings remained low.
Yeah.
And they had the numbers to justify cancellation.
Oh.
But little did we know. Once we were canceled, we went into syndication. And the syndicators decided to rerun us every day of the week, 5 days a week. And that's when we found the audience and the ratings soared. But it was too late. We were canceled.
Right.
But we showed those ratings people. 10 years later, we came back as a major feature film, and we're still continuing as a feature film with different actors playing the same roles.
Yeah.
And John Cho. Now, I look like John Cho.
right. During those years, you must have formed friendships with all of your castmates. I noticed Nichelle was at the
opening
opening of Allegiance. Is she your closest of the friends?
She's a very dear friend.
Yeah.
But, you know, many of them have become very dear friends.
Mm.
Jimmy Doohan is a great, down-to-earth, fun-loving guy.
Yeah.
I called him my favorite drinking buddy, and I learned a lot from him. Leonard Nimoy and I are political compatriots, and
okay.
we've worked on the same campaigns, issues and same candidates. And so, and Walter Koenig is a good friend. His wife went to school with me. I've been blessed with co-workers that have become lifelong friends. Walter was my best man at our wedding, and we asked Nichelle to be our matron of honor.
Mm. Let me ask you about that. Before you even get to the wedding, you, in at a certain point, decide you're going to, as they say, come out of the closet. And tell me what went into that period. This was 2005.
Five.
Yeah. Tell me about that discussion with Brad and your thoughts about it at the time and why you decided to come forward.
Having been incarcerated as a Japanese American, I was different enough. And so my whole life was to sharply and strongly closet myself and work at being popular. You know, I was active in all these other social justice movements, the civil rights movement. I met and marched with Dr. King, and during the peace movement, I was pursuing an acting career, and I joined the Hollywood a group called the Entertainment Industry for Peace and Justice, and worked side by side with people like Jane Fonda and Donald Sutherland. I was active in other areas, but closeted there. But things, because of the activism of those gay liberation people, things were starting to happen. People's minds were beginning to open up. Society was changing. And in 2005, an astounding thing that we never even dreamt of, the California State Legislature, the Senate and the Assembly, passed the Marriage Equality Bill. All it needed was one more signature, that of the governor, who happened to be a movie star, who, when he campaigned for the governor's office, campaigned by saying, "I'm from Hollywood. I've worked with gays and lesbians. Some of my best friends are," you know, the whole cliche bit. And when the bill landed on his desk for his signature, he played to his right-wing Republican base and vetoed it. And we were raging. But
this is Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
We were at home that night watching the late-night news, and we saw young people pouring out onto Santa Monica Boulevard. And they inspired us, and we began a conversation. Brad and I began a conversation. And I said, "Well, I've had a good enough career. I think I'm prepared to leave it. I'm going to come out." And I spoke to the press for the first time as a gay man, and I blasted Schwarzenegger's veto.
So that was a very conscious decision, and you knew, or you thought, that it could end your career.
Yes, I did. And the polar opposite happened.
Yeah.
As a result of that, I got more guest shots on television shows as gay George Takei.
You talked about the fact that you're the first registered same-sex couple in West Hollywood. Tell me about that day, when you were able to finally publicly have this expression of love with Brad.
We felt a little bit awkward because here were all these people lined up, couples lined up, some who had gotten up, you know, like 3 o'clock in the morning to be first in line. But we had some political connections
right.
with the city council members, and so they shepherded us to the front
of the line.
And I felt again like a closeted couple, you know, not visible to the people lined up.
Right.
But they applauded us when we were ushered to the front of the line. And it was a heady day, exciting, joyful, and the congratulations from everybody, embracing and kissing.
Yeah.
You know, it was an absolutely unforgettable day for both of us.
I had a chance to see you the other night, opening night here in L.A. at the Aretani Theater. Allegiance is this really special musical, this play that I hope everyone will see. And it's in some ways your life. And
it's my parents, really.
Your parents. Tell us about that.
Well, the internment experience of Japanese Americans is now getting to be generally known, but they don't know the full damaging impact of the internment. Yes, internment took our business, our home, our bank accounts, our property, our freedom.
Talking about Americans,
right?
120,000 Americans of Japanese descent, two-thirds of them, I believe, native.
That's right. Born
here in America.
My mother was born in Sacramento. My father was born in Japan, but brought over when he was, I think, 8 years old to San Francisco by my widower grandfather. But we looked like the enemy, and therefore we were suspected of being potential spies, saboteurs, fifth columnists, and imprisoned in these barbaric prison camps. Right after Pearl Harbor, young Japanese Americans rushed to their recruitment centers, like all young Americans, to volunteer to serve in the military. They were denied military service and categorized as enemy aliens, which was totally irrational. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were born here, raised here, spoke English just like other Americans, but because of our faces, they were labeled enemy aliens. Mm-hmm. But a year into imprisonment, the government realized there is a wartime manpower shortage. How to justify tapping that manpower? And so they came down with a very sloppily put together loyalty questionnaire. I mean, just that notion is outrageous.
Yeah.
Everyone over the age of 17 had to respond to that questionnaire. Question 27 asked, in essence, will you bear arms to defend the United States of America? My mother had three young children, my baby sister, an infant, and she was behind American barbed wire fences, and she was being asked to bear arms to defend this country that was imprisoning her. It was preposterous. Question number 28 was even more insidious. It was one sentence with two conflicting ideas. It asked, will you swear your loyalty to the United States of America and forswear your loyalty to the Emperor of Japan? This being asked of Americans of Japanese ancestry. We never even thought of a loyalty to the emperor. And for the government to assume that there's a pre-existing, inborn loyalty, genetic loyalty, was insulting. Mm-hmm. So if you answered no, meaning I don't have a loyalty to the emperor to forswear, that no applied to the first part of the very same sentence. Will you swear your loyalty to the United States? If you answered yes, meaning I do swear my loyalty to the United States, then you were essentially confessing that you are now prepared to forswear your existing loyalty to the emperor and re-swear your loyalty to the United States. The amazing thing is thousands of young Japanese Americans bit the bullet, swallowed the ugly taste, and answered yes to those two offensive questions, and went and fought for this country. And they fought in a segregated all-Japanese American unit and literally used like cannon fodder, mm-hmm, on those European battlefields. And they fought with amazing courage, in fact, heroism. And they came back the single most decorated unit of the per capita of the entire Second World War, mm-hmm, the 442nd Regimental Combat Team.
Yeah.
There were others that said, yes, I'm an American, and I will fight for my country, but I will fight as an American if I can report to my hometown draft board with my family back home. I'll be like any American, and I have something to fight for then. Mm-hmm. But I will not go as an internee going from behind these barbed wire fences and put on the same uniform of the soldiers who will be guarding over my family imprisoned still in the internment camp.
And you were telling me your father, faced with this question, did what?
both my parents answered no to those questions. They said it's outrageous. I mean, how stupid do they think we are? Mm-hmm. I am a human being who has principles. I subscribe to the ideals of American democracy, and this is not democracy. And they answered no to those two questions, and therefore were categorized as disloyal. And we were transferred to a higher security camp, Tule Lake.
How old were you at the time, George?
I was 5 when we were incarcerated, and 6 when the loyalty questionnaire came down. Yeah. So I was 6 then. My brother was 5. And my baby sister was 1. It was in Arkansas, in the swamps. There were 3 layers of barbed wire fence, and they had 6 tanks patrolling the perimeter. Mm. Those tanks belonged on the battlefield, not circling a camp of people, Americans who were outraged by the goading of this government.
I wonder your father and mother after the war. What happened?
My parents decided to come back to Los Angeles. Our home was gone. My father's business was gone. I started school, and the teacher kept referring to me as the Jap kid, the Jap boy, which stung. Mm. But by that time, I was 8, and I understood that, you know, internment was a painful experience for my parents, so I didn't tell my parents that the teacher was calling me a Jap. Mm. I just swallowed it. And I hated that lady, Mrs. Rugen. But still, I was a kid, her student.
An American.
I had nothing to do with the Boer. Mm. And yet, you know, that prejudice was still very strong, and it was personified for me by Mrs. Rugen.
Just to finish on the allegiance point, I understand where the passion comes from for you when you were getting this off the ground. And going to San Diego, and then to Broadway, and now here in L.A.
It's my legacy project.
Enough! I don't want to remember anymore.
I've been talking about the internment story since my early 20s.
Yeah.
We helped found the Japanese American National Museum. It's been my mission in life to raise the awareness of this American story, and that it should not be repeated again. But allegiance today is so critically relevant to our times.
Is.
You know, when the same kind of mentality, this broad brush characterization of people of one faith as potential terrorists, or people, immigrants coming from south of the border as drug dealers, rapists, murderers, you know, it's that mentality of people as a negative is so chillingly real today.
Yeah.
Same thing that happened to us 76 years ago.
A lot of what people know about George Takei today, so those younger generation people, they know through Howard Stern, right? I mean, and you've in the George Takei that I hear on Howard Stern is not the George Takei I've ever talked to when we're at events at the Japanese American National Museum or wherever, when you're appearing on our TV show. There's something about how Howard and what he gets out of you. What is it with you and Howard Stern?
Well, I discovered when I wrote my autobiography that it is a requirement of publication to do the Howard Stern show. I was doing a play in New York, and so I went there, and they asked me to sit and wait. The receptionist came and said, he's ready for you, and ushered me into this tiny, cramped broadcast room. And I said, good morning, and he said, oh, you have a deep voice. Anyone with a voice that deep has to have I said, I beg your pardon? Are we on the air? And he said, yep. And I said, oh, my.
So that's where that came from.
And he had it on tape. And so from that point on, whether I'm there or not, when someone says something outrageous or does something outrageous, he presses that button and my voice comes on. Oh, my. He's the one that made Oh, my signature.
I didn't realize. Before I say goodbye, I want to circle back to you were going through the list of cast members and your friendship with each.
I know what's coming up.
Well, I wrote it down because there was one name that you didn't mention, William Shatner.
Uh-huh.
What about your relationship with William Shatner?
It's professional. He is someone who is a fine actor, but he is completely self-possessed, self-involved. He's self-centered, and it's very difficult at times. You know, television works fast, and sometimes the hours are long, and you get exhausted and a little testy, and he is a very difficult person to work with. The others felt the same way. Jimmy Doohan used to carry on at conventions, you know, much more passionately. He psychoanalyzes people he doesn't know. interesting guy. Fascinating guy.
Thank you so much. I really do appreciate the time.
Okay.
Thank you.
I thought you were going to end on Oh My.
We can end on that too. Thank you so much, George. My thanks again to George Takei for a wonderful conversation, and thank you for watching. If you want to watch it again, go to our KTLA5 YouTube channel where we post each program. You can hear our entire uncut conversation on my podcast, Frank Buckley Interviews. You can hear that wherever you listen to podcasts. A new podcast drops every Wednesday, and it's always free. Thanks for all the feedback on my social media pages. I really appreciated your messages of support after our first episode last Sunday. If you'd like to join the conversation, I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. Next week, our guest is Zainab Salbi, a woman who went from growing up in Saddam Hussein's inner circle to being in Oprah's circle of influence. Thanks again for watching, and until next time, I'll see you on the KTLA 5 Morning News.